show I dropped the weapon at the back of the utility. Shot fired.
A police helicopter watches on as the Wyambilla siege reaches its violent conclusion.
Two eyes of the siege on the charging ground. Number one is female, hard down, no movement.
Police are still piecing together Gareth, Nathaniel and Stacey Train's descent into violent extremism. But it's clear like-minded online communities played a role. One of the brothers was believed to have been a member of a prominent Telegram conspiracy group. Since the shootings, some members have reportedly expressed admiration for the murderous trio, one even urging others to follow their example.
It's part of feeding the fantasy that a lot of these conspiracy beliefs are based on, and seeing someone act out those beliefs reinforces the conviction that what they're doing is right and moral, and often the deaths themselves of the three people involved will be used to spur further conspiracy thinking, unfortunately.
Such spaces are typical of the emerging threat.
The far right is a really broad church. I think you'd be hard pressed to find a singular definition. So it can encompass everything from neo-Nazi beliefs, right-wing nationalism, to QAnon-type conspiracy beliefs.
They're a cocktail of views, fears, frustrations and conspiracies.
And the pandemic has poured fuel on the fire, creating new grievances, new conspiracies and an ideal environment for online radicalisation.
More time in those online environments without some of the circuit breakers of everyday life, like family and community engagement, work and school, created more extremists.
Last week, the Labor government flagged its intention to update counter-terror laws in light of the changing threat.
A very large group of people who are of interest, who subscribe to various forms of right-wing kind of nationalism, Nazism, those sorts of things, and it's obviously enormously concerning.
But with a threat so hard to define and hidden at the margins of our society, how do we head off the next horror attack?
Dr. Mark Briskey is a former Queensland police officer who, since leaving the force, has become an expert in hate crimes and extremism. He joins us now. Dr. Mark, this is a harrowing thought, but do you think there are more Gareths, more Nathaniels, more Stacys out there?
Thank you for the question. Unfortunately, I do believe that is the case. We've only to see the reports from ASIO over the last couple of years reporting on the incredible rise in far-right type extremism and investigations they're pursuing.
And yet, I mean, if you take away the violence of this and you look at the views that are being espoused, they're not altogether unfamiliar, you know, some of the anti-vax stuff, for example, the idea that, you know, the government's not to be trusted. I kind of feel like just about everybody knows someone who would have, like, some elements of those views in their worldview. How do you tell the difference between someone who's just entertaining those thoughts and someone who's actually dangerous?
It really occurs on a continuum, because there are certainly people with conservative views. It really becomes serious when people start to internalise this and believe, perhaps they start to have paranoid beliefs about government or other figures who are actively persecuting them, or the perception that they're being persecuted.
Dr. Mark, the government wants to update counter-terror laws. What could they actually do that would make a difference?
Well, I think the government, they're trying to keep up to speed with a lot of these militants or potential militants. In the previous government, outlawed the Sonnenkrieg division, a far-right group. But this horrific event will drive much more focus on these peripheral figures and the potential for violence.
But banning groups, I mean, how effective is that going to be? We saw even sort of at the tail end of that ISIS wave where there were, you know, we saw lone wolf terrorism emerging out of that. They weren't part of a group, you know, they didn't hold membership cards to anything like that. It was kind of a self-starting sort of thing. I would imagine in this case that will be just as true, perhaps even truer.
Yes, that's correct, Waleed. When people start engaging with other radicalised figures is usually when they get caught up in the spider web and get noticed by authorities. But you're quite correct saying that the lone wolf phenomena is incredibly difficult to identify individuals that don't communicate either with locally based radicals of similar thoughts or international figures.
Dr. Mark Briskey, thank you for joining us. Thanks for taking us through it.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.